growth in Ghana's industrial sector has been mainly been driven by the mining and quarrying subsector, of which oil production has become an important component. The industrial sector has performed poorly in years in which the minerals and oil sector does not perform well, and vice versa. So when minerals and oil sector performs well, industry performs well. If they don't, industry doesn't. It should rather be manufacturing that should be driving this sector, not minerals and oil, because the job absorption effects of the growth in these sectors are not significant. They are not very labor intensive. The medium-term projections in the 2020 budget indicate that industrial sectors growth will continue to be largely dependent on minerals and oil production. Industry is expected to grow by 8.6% in 2020, but growth will dip to 3.3% in 2021. Why that is the case, I don't know, and further to 2.3% in 2022. This projected trend is mainly informed by expected sharp decline in oil production from existing oil fields. So again, you see the challenge. If you depend on oil, over depend on oil and gas, when there's a decline in output within this, it's likely to affect the industrial sector as a whole. The implication is that government's key policies or programs for the industrial sector, particularly the 1D1F, aimed at revitalizing manufacturing sector, may not be able to produce results that could offset shocks to the mining and quarrying sector, at least not in the short to medium term. So, while the 1D1F program generally appears laudable, it seems the 2020 budget presents no clear policy direction on how to address or cope with the dependence on the minerals and oil sector in the short to medium term. Still on 1D1F, the 2020 budget indicates that there are about 150 districts for which no private business operator has shown interest in, and that government is committed to identifying and supporting private investors for these districts. If no private investor has shown interest in some of the districts after nearly 3 years of implementing the program, then it appears that the perceived return on private investment in these districts may be considerably low among potential investors, despite a host of incentives in the form of tax holidays, exemptions from imports, duties, etc., offered by the government. In other words, the economic viability of establishing factories in some of these districts may be very low, begging the question of whether every district should have a medium to large scale factory as being perused under the 1D1F program. So should it be 1D1F, one district, one factory? If some districts are not appealing to investors, perhaps we may have to take another look if some districts could have two and others could move to. So perhaps it is time to revisit the ambition and focus policy attention on projects that show significant long-term viability than to have many projects, of which many may not hold limited long-term commercial potential.